Alrighty, well, welcome to 5G technology trials and testing. This is providing you a sneak peek into the future of wireless communications. I'm very lucky. As Sharp was describing to you, over the years I've worked as an industry analyst focused on mobile infrastructure, having an opportunity to engage with top thought leaders throughout the industry, so the major equipment suppliers, players in the broader ecosystem, silicon suppliers, software suppliers, software developers. So I'm just very fortunate because I've been engaged with these folks as we've made that journey from 2G to 3G to 4G, and now we're on the cusp of moving into 5G. No question, 5G is important. It's bringing new capabilities that remove LTE barriers and limits, essentially unlocking the imagination for developers that perhaps have not been born yet or in university today. It creates disruption. The disruption comes from the generational change impact that arises as incumbent operators look at their needs as a technology is changing and examine the supplier community that's servicing their needs presently. So it becomes an opportunity for new players to perhaps eliminate their competition. It provides a new access method, which raises the possibility of new entrants coming in to challenge operators in the community. And it brings new capabilities, which creates opportunities in the enterprise to reinvent the way the enterprise conducts its business. For sure, 5G is already several years into the journey of bringing the next generation. We've had moves in the academic community early on. NYU, tremendous research in millimeter wave propagation channel models. We've had tremendous activity in the supplier community. We've seen announcements from all major players for millimeter wave demonstrations. This is nothing new. Now, with enough knowledge and practice in these early academic and laboratory environments that were very restricted, very experimental, we're ready to move, and we actually have already moved closer to the field where end users are taking advantage of devices and technology. And of course, that comes with trials and tests in the confines of operator organizations, and in the not too distant future, taking it to the street where limited deployments start to occur in trial environments to gain experience under real-world environments. So today we're going to examine some of those efforts, either underway or planned, to evaluate this next generation. So to kick off our discussion today, I'm fortunately joined by a panel of experts from across the ecosystem who are going to share with you their perspectives based on where they're coming from. And there's going to be a certain order to this madness. We're going to start off with an overview, an industry context, from the head of 5G of Americas. And if you don't know about 5G Americas, shame on you, because this is a consortium of players in the United States, Canada, and south of the border, throughout South America, engaged in the entire ecosystem of bringing communication services to fruition. So Chris Pearson will provide us that overview. Then Carolyn Chan from Intel will give us a view from the broader ecosystem that makes it possible for devices and applications to enter into the consciousness of enterprises and end users. This is going to be followed by Nick Sandy from Nokia, who's has worked to make early trials in 5G fruitful, and he'll share with us some of his experience. And lastly, we get a valuable perspective from Craig Sparks, who provides an operator view coming from a very interesting operator. CSpire is a very nimble entrepreneurial operator in the southern United States, and I think he'll share with us how CSpire intends to make waves, so to speak, in the industry. So let me kick that off with Chris. Now, Chris, you had a couple of slides, which unfortunately we don't have on this thing, so if you could just speak to them.
Yeah, no problem.
All right, thank you.
Yeah, so I'm Chris Pearson, 5G Americas, and honored to be here as part of this distinguished panel. So just to kind of give a, kind of an overview of, kind of 5G Americas industry perspective of where we are and where we're going. Number one, we know as an association that there are a lot of announcements going on out there. Specifically, some are tied to major sports events around the world. Others are trials and testing and announcements around commercial or deployments and so forth. So there's a lot going on in 5G and a lot of focus and effort, which we feel is great for the industry. In fact, 5G Americas has been working for 2.5 years on technical recommendations and spectrum recommendations and so forth. But really, if you start looking at the timelines for everything that needs to be done and you want to start to look at an industry perspective from when does the big ecosystem of commercial standardized products and services begin to start hitting the market and starting to grow, you're really looking at a story of about 2020 and beyond. And if you look at the success of our industry, it has been a focus, whether it was GSM or wideband CDMA or LTE, focused on standard-based solutions so that all the companies across that ecosystem can innovate, but innovate on top of a standard that everybody has committed to. So we feel like the 2020 and beyond for commercial standardized products and services is the story from 5G America's standpoint. And one of the things that we find as a key to where we are in this industry is most companies, and I would say most companies on this panel and throughout 5G America's, we're not waiting for 5G. And if you look at the increases in innovation and development and even the recent announcements on deployments, you'll see that LTE, LTE Advanced, LTE Advanced Pro is continuing to innovate and even address some of the areas that we began talking about with 5G. So it's not like when we see opportunity that the industry is waiting. We see opportunity and we go to the standards-based solutions at 3GPP and we bring those opportunities to the marketplace. An example would be, if you start thinking about what 3GPP did with LTE Advanced Pro in release 13, it was, okay, there's an opportunity on IoT. But we have to address this market a little bit differently in IoT than we have before. And so we've created new technical standards that would be more narrowband focused, lower power focused, and longer battery life focused. That had been something that we really hadn't done quite yet. So again, that's just an example. So the industry is building this foundation, this kind of mobile broadband foundation for 5G, as at the same time, we are hard charging as an industry to get that 5G spec done. And if you start to look at, kind of the timelines of that spec for 5G, you'll see at 3GPP, where the specs is gonna be created, The first phase of that standard will be the second half of 2018, and the second phase, that will be December of 2019, and that'll be just in time for the ITU evaluation process that for IMT 2020 in 2020. So the industry is moving forward at a fast pace, but at the same time, we are not waiting to offer solutions. You've seen announcements by North American carriers in the last 3 weeks. I think you'll continue to see announcements by North American carriers about their development of LTE, LTE Advanced, LTE Advanced Pro, and our market, our industry will continue to progress. The last thing I would want to talk about is from an industry perspective, spectrum. And we all know spectrum is really the oxygen for our industry. And if you look at 5G, we're going to be looking at spectrum a little bit differently. Really, you're going to have licensed, shared, and unlicensed like never before. You're going to look at the different tiers of spectrum being low, mid, and high, and new definitions of really what high band spectrum is. Anyone that's been in the industry for very long knows at one point we actually thought, 3.5, that's kind of high spectrum. But as we saw with the U.S. taking a lead and bringing out millimeter wave or frontier spectrum, that they call it, it's at 28 gigahertz, 37 gigahertz, and 39 gigahertz. So it's a whole new kind of mentality of what we want to utilize and how we're going to do it. And it's an exciting time in the industry. So thank you.
Lovely. Carolyn, could you reflect on the broader ecosystem?
Yeah, so I'm came from the Intel data center group. So we've been working on providing the silicon platforms and software for infrastructure for a while. As far as I'm concerned, I actually totally agree with you, Ken. The road to 5G started for us about 3 years ago, three, 4 years ago. We're doing the NFV SDN as a foundation. And if you look at 5G, to me, 5G is quite different from the previous generation, which had focusing on one type of application, maybe two, voice and data. But you look at 5G, what makes the ITU definition, it really is around, not just mobile broadband, but IoT, mission critical, and different enterprise applications. For that to truly have an impact on the business case, the bottom line, to make 5G worthwhile for deployment, you really look at what kind of business value we've been driving. So something that just, Ken, you know this, 3 years ago we started doing this mobile edge computing.
Yep.
Pushing the intelligence closer to the user at the edge of the network. If you look at what's happening, we just had an Intel developer forum. We are very fortunate to have the GE and the chairman of GE on stage with us and talking about the amount of analytics that he's getting from his Jack engine. The numbers are just enormous.
Staggering.
It's just totally staggering. That information, you could either, I think most of it today, did not get deeply analyzed, sends back to the cloud at a great cost of transport. But what we're proposing is pushing the intelligence, the storage, the CPU power to the edge, to machine learning. Intel just announced a couple of acquisitions of machine learning, deep learning. In using that information, gathering all the analytics right at edge with some instant reaction, for example. We've done, hopefully later on Nick may talk about it, we've done some trials with a Nokia around Formula One, racing, stadium. A lot of things need to happen, like security. Mm-hmm. You can't wait to get facial recognition down in the cloud. You gotta make decision right there, right now. You gotta look at what was it recently, LAX has a bomb, no, somebody thought there was a live shooter, it wasn't. That sort of information, but imagine everybody with the cameras, everybody with all the surveillance, you can put a instantaneous information, right? You know whether there is a shooter or a car backfire or somebody pop a balloon. That kind of information you don't need to wait, need to be instantaneous. So mobile edge computing really enhances IoT, and that's what we've been focusing on. So NIV SDN using using what IT is already comfortable with, the cloud technology, and transform that into a 5G network basis. That really merges the telco industry and the IT industry together. So we started this 3 years ago, we were laughed out by people, but now we actually have a 5G platform runs completely on the server. It's a CPU plus FPGA for acceleration. At this stage of the 5G, when the standard's not solidified, we believe this is the right platform for people to start doing early trials and deployment. So that's what we've been offering. Really echo what you said, it's an enterprise focus. 5G is, the difference is 5G is gonna be a lot of enterprise, maybe even a lot of private network, like Chris saying, there's a whole lot more spectrum out there.
Yeah.
Some are shared, some are unlicensed. I would not be surprised if we see a lot of vertical networks deployed on top of a general purpose, consumer oriented network like the operator does today.
Yeah, and for sure, when we talk about 5G, it's usually a very radio-centric discussion of millimeter wave, millimeter that. But the reality is there'll be a new system architecture as well.
Correct.
In terms of, how our core network operates, how we take advantage of virtualization, moving towards the network slicing so we can have creative ways to deliver services to customers that they just haven't had in the past. So it's much more than the radio topic, for sure.
Yeah, so my counterpart with the Intel focusing on the radio, on the 3GPP standard, on this side of the house, we're focusing on all the learning we've had in the cloud, working with the Super 7, and how we bring that knowledge, that the learnings into 5G, so that 5G is not just about voice and data, does not shortchange folks like CSpire who carries all this information, but you be able to monetize it, just like the way the OTTs are monetizing it. So that's what really, a combination of a mobile edge computing plus the radio technology and built on top of NFV, I think that's the focusing that our team's
Can you reflect on trial activities that you folks have been engaged in this domain?
So a lot of the things we've been doing are around prototyping. Like we're working with not yet announced consortium on network slicing. And really,
we're friends here, you can tell us.
And NDA barding. So we are doing prototyping. I think the trial obviously is happening now in North America as Chris alluded to, and there will be a lot more activities coming up in with Olympics, with the Winter Games and Summer Games are coming. Even someone has mentioned, but China is actually doing quite a bit of that.
I was going to ask you about that. You spend a fair amount of time in China. What's your observation for how this is evolving?
I don't think they want to be left behind. No offense, Chris. I mean, they always think we want to be part of it. I think the spectrum is challenging for them, right? They so far have not announced anything in the high bandwidth. So I think around 3.5, that's what we're being focusing on.
What type of test and trial activity are you seeing in China? Are they at the level that we're at in the U.S.?
Maybe not as a mature, but there's a lot of public announcement coming out. Definitely China Mobile and also a lot of national funding that is happening. NB-IoT is really going on. So we've been involved in some of the fundamental technology, working with folks like Nokia here and doing some of the early trial. But I would say probably, definitely the U.S. carriers a lot more vocal and probably with the fixed wireless.
Thank you. So Nick, you hover about in the northeastern United States, and you work with your operator customers to help them as they start looking at concrete examples of 5G. So would you share with us what you've learned and what you've seen through this process?
Yeah, sure. So actually, before I maybe go into some of the details around the trials, maybe I can give a brief context. So I'll briefly talk about what we believe this is all about, what we are trying to achieve, and then briefly touch upon the timeline, or where we are, what we see happening in the next couple of years. And then I'll cover also the some of the trial details.
Thank you.
So on the context first, we see basically 5 years of bigger change that we have seen on the previous generations. We see in a sentence, we see 5G being an unlimited experience for everything and enabling instant action. Everybody's referring to those three pillars, but that's the way we phrase it. And I also would like to add that we believe 5G is going to be so transformational that it's going to take the telco industry to be much more integrated and much more influential with all the other industries. In terms of timeline, well, right now we have a pre-commercial, pre-standard system that we are using to run trials with our partners. Just a couple of data points is, about a year ago, we completed some trial in Korea where we were achieving already speeds close to 20 gigabits per second. So those very high speeds are perfectly doable, actually are not the biggest or the most difficult requirement of 5G. Maybe even more interesting, in the recent 5G World Exhibition earlier this summer, Nokia was the first vendor to demonstrate a 5G ready network built upon commercially available products. So we are really trying to work to help the carriers to protect their investments now, as well as building a bridge towards 5G. We believe that is very important. In terms of, you know, what we expect or we see happening over the next months and year, mm-hmm. there is a lot of focus around certain use cases. For example, we see a lot of interest in fixed wireless access. Some carriers are, you know, very graphically saying 5G equals to wireless fiber, and that, you know, can be also transformational for the industry. Then maybe the last comment on the timeline is that we see the standard coming as, you know, it was already referred to in two steps, end of 18, end of 19. But I would like to say that Nokia is very active in the standardization bodies, and we would love to see even a further acceleration in the current schedule. Because we see a lot of interest in the industry, and if that would be possible, it can limit or reduce the risk of fragmentation. In terms of trials, some examples in the, especially in US, so we have completed or we are running trials with, in no particular order, companies like Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile, Sprint, and of course, C-Spire. And we got press releases with most of them, I think. One particular example, a trial that we ran early in June, it was a live demo in a stadium. In this particular case, we were demonstrating a use case of ultra high definition video. Mm-hmm. The system we were operating there was achieving speeds over 2 gigabits per second. So really getting close to the performance that potentially we can aspire in, with 5G. But for us, even more interestingly, although, of course, 5G is not only about the radio, in this particular case, we were working with 73 gigahertz band. And that is really a big change compared to the type of bands we have been using. It's impacting, of course, the amount of cells you will need. It's impacting the propagation model has to be different. Propagation model is something you need for your network design tool. Yeah. So it's affecting the whole thing. So one of the things we were also demonstrating there were propagation characteristics of this type of band through different building materials, okay. Right? So that is, in a nutshell, some of the activities we're running now.
And just to remind me, that frequency band was 28 gigahertz from the stadium?
In this case, I was referring to was 73, but we have running trials on both, 29, 38, and 73.
For the benefit of people who were not at the stadium, could you just describe what that experience looked like when you were doing the demos? What was in play?
Right. So, as I said, the main use case we were running was video streaming, okay. But 4K video streaming, mm-hmm. ultra-high definition. So, it's a similar, application to others you can have today, but with a much bigger resolution, and of course, mm-hmm. which means a lot of more data, and that's one specific example, right? But there are many use cases, of course.
How many devices were being demonstrated at the time?
Well, actually, those were like prototypes. Actually, the device it was big, right? So a lot of this is right now, of course, prototypes, and of course, it's pretty standard system.
But how many simultaneous were you trying to show at in this demonstration?
It was only a handful.
Okay. Yes. Was the core network located in the stadium when you were doing the trial?
Yes.
Was that everything was present in
yes.
that stadium?
Yeah.
What were the biggest challenges as you were trying to make this trial a success?
Well, I mean, part of it was, to of course develop the prototypes. As a vendor, we've been working, and the industry has been working for actually many years now to develop those prototypes and test some of these, 5G feature-like. And again, it's early days; the standard is not there, but there are many technologies we know we will need, and so we can already trial certain aspects of it. Yeah.
So when CSpire does a big demo, what recommendation would you make to, what learning did you take away from the experience in June?
Right, so.
Ours was in July with Nokia. Yeah, we were after this
demo.
They
did a demo.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, they did a demo.
Okay. Ooh.
So, basically we of course want the carriers with us to experience, to test those type of 5G use cases that will be more demanding. And as I was saying, in these trials, we also want to experience what are some of the challenges this type of high frequencies will impose, and of course, how the performance of the service can be impacted when the millimeter wave is going through different installation materials. So those were some of the things we were.
Okay, Craig, so you're moving faster than I thought. Why don't you share with us what you guys have learned and your perspective on moving forward with additional trial work.
All right, well, thank you, Ken, for having me. So I'll give you a bit of an introduction on CSpire. We're a wireless carrier headquartered in Ridgeland, Mississippi, the nation's sixth largest and the largest privately held. CSpire is a wireless 3G, 4G CDMA carrier, also with a lot of long-haul fiber across the state and a fiber to the home GPON business as well. And so when you put all those together, all of the ingredients, I guess, the chess pieces you need on the board for a robust 5G implementation are there for CSpire, and it's a very interesting set to be working with. And we actually have 28 gigahertz, which should be the seminal band in the United States, at least, for 5G. And right now, what we had in terms of trials, we did one in July with Nokia, located in our headquarters. And we made sure at that time not to just be doing arbitrary data over it, but we actually hooked up the core from our video distribution network, our GPON fiber to the home IPTV service, and ran that over their system.
So this wasn't just a sterile, isolated
network? It's a baby step. And there's a lot of baby steps.
There are going to be many of them.
There are going to be many of them, yes. Over the next few years. And of course, the next baby steps are to take those to the, to 28 gigahertz. There are, there will continue to be proof of concept type trials like we've talked about so far, and then pre-commercial implementations in 17. And hopefully, even though this is the interesting thing about 5G, and I want to reiterate your comments that you made about the focus in the press, and everybody is so hyper focused at the moment about the RAN, the RAT side of it, and the access and technologies and 28 and propagation models. But from a carrier's perspective, those will work themselves out. The things that we see are most disruptive are the completely new core architectures and the interoperability back on the mobility side with 4G networks, and specifically things, the network functional virtualization functions and the slicing. I mean, if we had a crystal ball and could look ahead 10 years, things like roaming don't look like roaming anymore. They just look like, to borrow a term from programmers, if I have all the infrastructure and all of that's in place and I've got all the 5G and the 4G bands somebody needs, they don't roam into me anymore. I just show them that I have a minimally compliant network to what they need, and they just slice. The networking term is they create an instance of their network into mine. I don't even need to know what they're doing. They're not roaming anymore. Those are the most disruptive things about the transition from 4G and 5G from the carrier's perspective that we've all got to work with our partners in this case to stay on top of. And I just wanted to reiterate what you said earlier about that. That said, on the fun part is to talk about the RAT.
Part we all
gigahertz.
Like.
Yeah, well, let's leave the hard work and just talk about the fun part, which should be on wireless local loop. All the old problems are new again, right, in terms of fiber to the home. It's one of the use cases in the United States from the carrier's perspective, from Verizon's holdings in 28 and options to lease and XO and everything they've put together. It's the part everyone wants to talk about, and we have an IPTV service, so it is of interest to us, and we can do that as carriers pre-standard first. It's such a localized frequency, as long as I'm willing to, and I want to reiterate some of, I don't know if we were with you at the NYU or the Rutberg event, but the AT&T.
NYU.
The AT&T perspective that was reiterated there is, hey, make sure you guys, whatever you do, whatever you put on the ground pre-standard, that you don't come in and hamstring the eventual implementation and cry foul and say, I'm sorry, you can't do this slick new feature in 3GPP because I've got all this stuff on the ground and I'd have to rip and replace it. And I want to reiterate, from our perspective, that we definitely, whatever comes in on the mobility side, on the fixed wireless side,
we want to, you know, we have the flexibility to choose to rip and replace that equipment if it's incompatible on the side. So if we're doing what amount to neighborhood small cell, you know, streetlight type implementations and coming through a residential area with wireless local loop, fiber to the home replacement, all the things that are interesting to us, and this is, I want to reiterate, you know, when you speak with the Japanese and the Korean carriers, we're all interested in the use cases right now. They are focused on the Olympics coming up for both of them. Indeed. And so the mobility side and they have to do the demonstrations with gutted handsets and tablets on the ground and mobility. And they're actually looking to us in the U.S. on the wireless side. And I know mobility will come a little sooner than people are thinking, even in the U.S. But that said, we're a little more focused on the fixed wireless implementation. But when you merge all those together, we're both looking at each other, all the carriers are looking at each other, wanting to know a detailed breakdown on the use case and how these networks are designed and how they scale. If I go and look at my fiber installation and I know the CapEx and the OpEx and the, you know, the cents per mile for the fiber, I want to sit there and come back and I know what it costs, and it's, you know, I think you've seen the press from Google and all that before. It's not the easiest business to be in. And when you look back, that I've got this 5G and all of this has got to come in. It's got to undercut that by a particular margin and prove that we can scale. And so we're all very interested in the use cases and how dense they are and what are the propagation models. Am I having to put this every other street light? Can I cover a huge subdivision with one cell? Am I better off with going with LAA and putting 3.5 in there? You know, and when you actually are already in IPTV and gigabit fiber to the home, carrier, you have to wonder how these are going to scale in terms of the number of beams. How many homes or residential areas can I cover with individual beams? And then what is the aggregate throughput of these installations? Because now what am I going to do if I'm selling one neighborhood over, I'm selling gigabit Ethernet for $80 a month. And then, you know, the next neighborhood over, here comes 5G 28, and the people at the front of the neighborhood are getting 2 plus gigabits. The folks at the back are only getting 100. And, you know, how am I all charging them? There's a lot of, I would say, consternation and interest in these trials and testing over the next few years to understand how to bookend, really, the performance expectations.
What's the reality?
Consternation would be the term. We're all eagerly awaiting the testing and trials over the next year and a half to understand what even pre-commercial, pre-standard implementations, they will be commercially viable. They'll in 18 and beyond, but they'll be pre-standard, and we just really want to know what those are after. And I want to conclude with one of the other major concerns from a carrier's perspective is on this hardware, the streetwear, right? The street furniture, if it were. There's a really intense need on the industrial design and the investment going into that base station equipment and its physical size, for instance, at 28 that it allows. You know, there was a period when it was unfashionable to be on a phone or talking on one in public. There is a period when you actually, and those days are long gone, obviously. And today, in terms of the battle you have with neighborhood associations, city managers, mayors, and it just goes on up, in terms of the hardware that we're going to deploy for 5G, there's a lot of interest from the carriers on that street furniture is a pain point in terms of its industrial design and its camouflage. Does it look like a street light, or does it look like, if you take a traditional, even small cell, chunk of aluminum the size of a suitcase and hang it off of a, you know, for 28, that just doesn't scale. And people, at the density we need to deploy these implementations, there's some concern about taking that ID seriously. I think, if we had that 10-year crystal ball, there'll be a point where the benefits outweigh and people will accept, you know, good industrial design in this space from folks like Nokia and others that are working. But we'll have a first impression threshold the first few years of these commercial deployments from 18 to, let's say, 22, where we've all got in the industry to commit to that industrial design conversation and help these city mayors and neighborhood associations just make that initial transition to viable deployments.
I pulled out onto Las Vegas Boulevard yesterday to go run up and visit, meet a friend, and I saw low on a pole, I think a quote small cell site, and it
quote,
was appalling.
Small cell. Yeah.
Appalling that somebody would deploy.
Looks
that.
Like a good home for a squirrel.
It is unbelievable. If somebody tried to put that outside my house, I think I'd be picketing my city hall. So clearly, there's a lot of work that needs to be done in the vendor community as well as in the operators to be sensitive to the communities that this equipment is being planted in. And that's even putting aside the RF concerns that you know, are out there. So, interesting. What would you, so you've gone through trials. Yeah, you've got your supplier over here, one of them. What do you want to see him do better?
I would just rightfully, you know, have a frank conversation here with us. We're all friends, right?
We are.
Really, what's been going on?
Everybody signed an NDA when they walked through the door.
Yeah. What's been going on in 16 is technically proof of concepts, right? The trials will come at the end of this year and through spring of next. And those really are, I mean, those are not, they won't be commercially viable hardware. They won't look right. They won't cost right. They won't weigh right. But they will prove the technology out. You'll be able to look at the models, the budget. You know, you'll actually be able to plan that out. You know, is the antenna going to work inside, completely indoor? Do I need to crack a window and hang something out the window? Do I need to go to the side of the house? Do I, you know, what link budget am I leaving on the table if I don't put something on the roof? You know, and those are all, the most painful thing for carriers and why this is so interesting would be a completely indoor solution. I drop ship, you know, I don't even carry the inventory. I just push a button and they drop ship it from a third party, and it's a consumer self-install, versus the opposite is, oh, do you mind if I climb on your roof and drill some holes? You know, but understanding the performance of that whole system and what we get out of it. And like I said, working backwards against that fiber deployment model and knowing how far back off of that margin you need to come before it tilts in an Excel spreadsheet to where you say, there, do it, right? And if you work that backwards today, you know, and Nokia and others, there's a disruptive model to small cells, and a lot of folks that are trying to get those down to $2,000, not $20, not $200, you know, and we just don't know where the 28 hardware is going to scale, but it's got to scale down. And then, like you said, to finalize the interaction of the 4G networks and the 5G and actually having the best of your wireless and wireline design with that fiber and the wireless and making all that happen. It's an exciting time. The next 5 to 10 years.
Now, Chris, you're kind of in the middle of this exciting time because there's a lot of heavy lifting needed to break through regulatory barriers, to get industry partners to cooperate a bit better and work in a more synergistic fashion. And 5G America, I mean, recently renamed, you used to be 4G America. So 5G America is clearly focused on this target. Could you just describe what have been the biggest challenges that you folks have been undertaking?
Well, I mean, I think it's it just depends. I think there's a challenge every few months as far as, but I think the industry is moving forward on most of them. I mean, 5G America's, when we were looking at technical recommendations, we were early in the process. So what we were trying to do is get the industry to start thinking about, okay, hey, we think 5G is coming. This is some of the technical concepts that we want. And we gathered our members to say, as a group, you know, going to be able to influence the standards and process in other organizations as well. So that came together quite well, and it continues to come together. The next challenge is spectrum. Okay, there, you know, you know, 5G has to be, as I said in my opening comments, not just a spectrum story at, you know, the high band, but it has to be about mid and low and all different kinds of spectrum. But one of the challenges is the high band, and that's what the testing is going in. So, you know, what we've been doing a lot of is talking to governments throughout the Americas and then in the U.S. filing with the FCC, making sure they understand that this is different spectrum for the mobile industry, that this is spectrum that, you know, we need large chunks of for it to work with the limited propagation and the types of data rates that we need. And luckily, we felt that the FCC listened quite a bit to 5G Americas and other associations too that filed comments with them to make large swaths of spectrum available. So, you know, the challenges are there, but, you know, organizations like 5G Americas, I think, are gathering their members together to, you know, be a part of that conversation and influence the direction of 5G. And so I think it's actually going, you know, pretty well as in the Americas market. Now in Latin America, it's a little different.
Yeah.
In Latin America, what we're finding is the conversations, you know, they still have a fair amount of spectrum in the cupboard, as we say, in certain countries. And the other thing is there's more of a kind of a holistic approach to how they look at, you know, what 5G is. For one thing, LTE is just now kind of taking off. I mean, you know, it's gone to about 12% market share of all their mobile connections. So there's a great deal of growth still left in LTE and even the LTE Advanced, you know, kind of roadmap. But what they're looking at is, well, how does 5G and even LTE Advanced Pro help connect my society and improve quality of life? How could it be a disruption to on a positive side to help education, to help healthcare, to help, you know, transportation, these types of things? So it's a very interesting approach that they're taking to, you know, what can it do to help us? And then once we figure that out, then I think then they'll look at the economics that arise with the business and technical side.
What nations stand out to you in South America for perhaps being a little more forward-thinking towards 5G? So perhaps, you know, get over the digital divide with where copper, it's not so easy to put copper out there or fiber.
Right. None actually, I would say, stand out at this time. Really? Okay. I mean, it's so early in the process because of the fact that LTE Advanced and LTE Advanced Pro have a long ways to go there, and they're looking at those technologies. In fact, we've been just recently wrote a paper on education in Latin America and how mobile broadband can help that and so forth. So I think, you know, most of the countries are kind of really focused on LTE and what it can do, but the questions they're asking about, you know, they hear about, you know, 5G and they know it's coming and they want to know, well, how can that help us even more?
What's your take on the Canadian experience with
I think
advanced technology?
You know, the Canadian experience is such that, you know, they're so tightly coupled
with the U.S.
In everything from historically their band plans, historically their technology. So I think it's still, you know, kind of a wait and see. But I would imagine that, you know, you would see, you know, similarities between the two because of the common border.
So if I could just change the topic a bit, Nick, I think you've got a pretty strong professional services background. And when you look at the major players that are equipment suppliers, much of their business today is professional services. If we look at 5G, these trials that are going to be ramping up over time, can you just reflect on what the role of professional services mean, how it might change going forward?
Yeah, no, that's a great point. So, I mean, in the trials we're running and, of course, in the discussions we are having with our customers for the plans for the coming years, we see services, I mean, professional services being probably even more important than they have been in the previous generations. And I can maybe give, two examples. So one example is around, coming back again to this high-frequency band. So in this type of centimeter, millimeter wave band, the 5G deployment is going to be a small cell. We even talk about ultra small cells. And as an industry, and this is the Tower and Small Cell Summit, the industry has been having a hard time to actually deliver this small cell promise of these, you know, tens of thousands. Yeah. It has been really challenging. And this is not simply a technology problem. It's more complicated than that. We see this as a techno-economical problem, try to get the right size that will provide you the right return with the right TCO, total cost of ownership. And this is going to be even a bigger challenge in 5G. So from that perspective, I think it's going to be important that carriers partner with companies that have innovative solutions in the network densification deployment space. The second example is around, if we go back to this type of very low latency requirements of latencies of 1 millisecond or few milliseconds, there are some limits that that physics is. So at the speed of light, in 1 millisecond, you make a round trip of 90 miles. So this means that we see the 5G network architecture as being very different. There will be many data centers and different layers of it. There will be, you know, some larger centralized ones, but many, many distributed data centers that have to be really close to the end user. This requirement, together with some other of the ambitions of 5G, like network slicing that we were talking about before, we believe network design is going to be very different. Mm-hmm. And from that perspective, again, it's important for the carriers to partner with companies that will have both the 5G technology understanding as well as strong network design capabilities.
Caroline, there's been a lot of work in ETSI with mobile edge computing, which is kind of the forebearer of what 5G will have with its the approach Nick was talking about to try to drive latency down. How is that effort going? Is it solidifying in terms of the architecture for the mobile edge computing, and will that be enough, or does more work need to occur before mobile edge computing is ready for prime time in a 5G environment?
Well, actually, I'll answer twofold. So number one is the first release of the MEC standard is coming out. Mm-hmm. In fact, ETSI just approved extension of it to have a follow-on stage. Just like you said, because all the 5G, it's funny, it's like the more you do, the more you learn, and you realize it's not never enough. Yeah. You can never graduate from that. But what we have done today, so far, has seen quite a few trials. I know Nokia has announced several, including one that's a ADAS, assisted driving, with Deutsche Telekom. It was actually, you can Google it. I think they even put a YouTube out there by Deutsche Telekom. We've seen a lot of even early deployment in China by their local vendors. One example that we are in participating in was a augmented reality one. So talking about low latency, it's a very highly critical one. The example was the National Museum of China realizing they did I don't know how they tested, but they did some clocking, realizing the teenagers, typically, I'm Chinese, I can say that we have 5,000 year history. A museum takes you forever to go through. You take you hours. But these kids breathe through in 20 minutes. They don't care. They just walk through, take a couple of pictures and gone. They're done and out there sitting in Starbucks waiting for, going home or doing whatever. And then they were just deeply disappointed that this is happening. No one's paying attention. In order to draw the attention of them, they're realizing the common denominator is that they all got a phone. So they reach out to us, and then we found one of our partners that did an application runs with China Mobile running on their phone. Essentially, we have these ancient paintings. It's just so little faded. The colors are faded, really complicated with old characters no one can read. So you put a picture on it. I think that particular one was a Ming Dynasty painting. So you put a picture on it, and then the backstory comes up. Everything came to animation.
Okay. Yeah, makes it real shows, for the
makes
person.
It real for the kids.
Yep.
Like, I may spend time that you read it and recall the story that told by the teachers and grandparents. They came in was cartoon characters and telling the best story why this is happening. And that, they actually started some early trial and deployment in one of the provincial museums and saw some, pretty good results. I don't know whether they publicly announced or not, but we have taken a portion of that and been showing that in different demos with their permission. In this case, we did a Mona Lisa story, we did an Eiffel Tower story, and myself, I'm just taking it in a very idea that, hey, why couldn't I? When I go to the store, when I look at a dress, I'm thinking, oh, this is going to look great on me. And then I'm going to invest in going to the dressing room and realize, what was I thinking? All I want to do is to take a picture and point my camera, look at that dress, and put myself in it. I could tell 50% of the time whether it's a fit or not before people even invest in going to the dressing room. Just some real practical. So we've seen that some deployment early already in shopping malls in China. And so on. So there are pockets of early deployment and trialing that are happening around a lot of retail. So at the end of the day, if I were going to go to CSPI and say, hey, do mobile edge computing, many times we found that we actually had to bring the entire ecosystem to the operators, including the enterprise side, which is, this is where being part of Intel actually helps because we do talk to the IT department. And then the other thing I was going to say is that with 5G, I found myself, besides talking with you guys, and I've been actually approached by a lot of CIOs and say, can you please talk to us about what does 5G mean to a CIO of an enterprise company?
It's a very important question.
Yeah. Some of them runs their own private network. Talking about being professional services, they used to run in Wi-Fi. Now they're thinking, hey, I heard this new Fandango thing, Spectrum coming out. Are they capable of running a full wireless network, 5G? I think something like professional service from you, probably going to be a very important part of it. So I'm scheduled to talk to CIO of a major Chinese firm, and I'm going to pose that question. So they run a private network today. I think they run through an operator today because they claim to have some national security data they cannot put on a China mobile network. So going forward, they think, hey, could I not run a private network that I control? Some data will go to the public network, some data I need to keep. So in that sense, security, partitioning, and really running a VNF is what they want. Because mm-hmm. VNF to them means I control that. Maybe it's your network, but I control it. That piece I want to control is mine, and you don't see it. Certainly my competitor will never see it, never be leaked somewhere else. So that's my taking, what I think 5G will be fundamentally different, could be even a different business model that creating opportunities for newcomers and some old people. Mm-hmm.
I'm intrigued by this concept of a trial that ends up touching end users. So many of the trials are by necessity, they're very technology oriented. We need to get a better understanding of propagation techniques and characteristics. But 5G, if it is successful in eliminating the rigid barriers that we have with LTE, rigid frame structure, channel sizes, latency constraints, if we're successful in sweeping away these limits, what does it unleash in terms of new applications that we can't imagine just being mere technologists that worry about bits and RF? And perhaps when we get a year from now, it would be time for trials that give enterprises, the college students, people who can come at this with a fresh set of eyes and not be wrestling with the barriers that we've had in the past. So perhaps a new set of trials will be needed. Craig, let me ask you, so you've been in the networks business with operators for a long time, and you're looking at this new technology coming at you. What part of the technology story are we missing now? What still needs to be done from your point of view?
Ask that again in a different way.
Well, we've got 5G, we've got the standards coming into place. What's missing? What do you think we need to fill in as gaps in our approach? Or is this just simply an RF game where we go bigger, faster?
No. One of the hallmarks that is popular to talk about on the 5G are the multi-gigabit speeds and high spectrum. But one of the other, I'll use that crystal ball 10 years from now point earlier, is 5G, 10, 15, 20 years from now, is, commingled. 4G's still here, mm-hmm. 10, 15 years. And it's not about the ultra high frequency. 600 megahertz auctions going on right now in the US, in North America. There'll be, there are use cases for ultra low power wide, low power wide area networks that are 5G, 15 years from now, that are all the battery operated low modules. It's just the attention's not there on that entire swath, but 5G won't be just about the high speed, high frequencies. It'll be about the ultra-low speed, ultra-low frequencies. Right. And that'll be true in South America as well at 450 megahertz. That said, the one thing as a carrier that causes me initially, it's all about first impressions. Mm-hmm. When this is a commercially viable pre-standard in 18 and commercially viable in 20 post-standard, it's, I think, the industrial design discussion and where we go with small cells, and the fiber backhaul requirements, and the higher frequency wireless backhaul requirements to these cells to bring this vision for 5G together. It's a lot of work to dig the ground up to throw fiber in it, and you've got to make sure that we have other options.
Lovely. Chris, do you have any views on what might be missing?
I think The key thing in 5G, and it was the same with the other technology that we deployed, is just looking at marrying the economics of the business case with the technical side. Mm-hmm. So carriers are out to do their best for the customers, but in the end, they have to get paid for it.
They have shareholders.
Yeah, they have shareholders or private shareholders, I guess, in some cases. So yeah, so
still need to get paid.
So I think, you know, the key thing that I think we need to keep our eye on the prize is that we have to marry the business and the technical, because you know, again, carriers need it, you know, to get paid for the hundreds of millions or billions that they're going to invest in 5G. So it would be important to keep an eye on that.
That becomes a regulatory challenge as well. If the regulatory environment's not conducive to being able to charge.
Oh, well, yeah, I mean, yeah, I mean, that's a whole different panel, I think. But, you know, but I, the one thing I'd kind of talk about, and this is what, I mean, you know, what keeps you up at night, you know, this is a little bit of really what Craig said, but it's just like, if you look at 5G being successful, you need densification of your network. Yeah. And for densification of the network, you still have some of the same challenges. And those challenges are you know, the municipalities that are controlling the regulations on cell siting, the backhaul, the power, the industrial design, as Craig would say. These are things that you'll still have to be, it doesn't matter what G you use. No, I mean, we can be in 6G, you're still gonna need cell siting to be streamlined. And in the U.S., we have lots of municipalities, and we have a free market and democratic society. Other parts of the world, I think you're going to see it a little bit easier for those deployments.
All right, let me give you guys a final word, just a reflection from each of you. Either your biggest surprise over the recent time as you've gone through trial processes, or your choice, what you expect to see in the year coming. So, Carolyn, why don't we start with
you? So, if we were at the same panel next year, I would like to see not just the usual people like carriers and
I call them suspects.
Usual suspects. I would like to see on this panel talking about 5G, someone from American Airlines, GE, Google, Amazon. For once, people who build the network should get paid properly. Pay more than just the consumer paying for it. The folks that runs their traffic on it should be part of it. Including requirements, maybe help with the deployment, really changing the business model. And you know, I love you guys, but I would like to see more varieties and diversities of ecosystem talking about 5G and how to make 5G work.
Caroline, you're a dreamer. All right, Craig.
Well, to reiterate that, you know, 5G will be sitting on, to Chris's point, licensed, unlicensed. Yeah. There'll be a lot of disruptive folks in this model and combinations of that. The one thing I'll say, I'll just look ahead. I'll take your chicken exit on the second option and say, you know, if we had, what will we be talking about a year from now? You'll see in the first quarters, honestly, in Korea and Japan preparing for the Olympics, you'll see them doing outdoor trials on the mobility side at 28 at gigahertz with pre-standard 28. In the U.S. in that same time frame, you'll see wireless local loop, fixed wireless implementations that won't just be trials. They'll be friendly customer user trials where they'll put the put the equipment on the ground and watch it for a while.
Yeah.
Collect large statistical models during for the whole year for foliage change, all kinds of stuff.
Interesting.
Agree.
Lovely. Nick?
I want to add on what Caroline was reflecting. I think it's a very important comment. So I was saying before that we see 5G staking the telco industry to be much more influential and integrated with all the other industries. The list of possibilities that 5G is bringing is very long. You know, I mean, I'm not going to go through all the many use cases, but also the ability of the carrier to give completely different set of value out for the different type of customers is a much wider space. So to monetize that is not going to be good enough that, you know, a couple of flat fee models. There has to be a lot of even experimentation about, trialing different models, see what works, go back, do something else, and we cannot figure this out only by ourselves, by the telco industry. if we need to provide all that value add and capture it and monetize it, we need to work with all those other industries.
I wonder if Chris is going to go out and try to recruit him into his organization. All right, Chris, you're going to take us home.
Take us home. Actually, I think I'll be real quick. A year from now, I think we'll be talking about how quickly the LTE advanced and 5G is progressing, both from the 5G, the trials, the test, the standard, and from LTE advanced, the deployments of the more advanced features in LTE Advanced Pro or 3GPP release 13 and 14.
Lovely. Please join me in thanking our panelists. This wonderful presentation.